Forward the light. Fall down. I'll lay my burden. Good morning, Lighthouse.
Good morning.
So glad that all of you are here. And as you can tell, we are gearing up around here for LC3 Youth Camp. And we are super excited about that. Yeah, you can go ahead and shout it out right there. I know last year we were unable to go and do that. So this year we are coming back so much stronger, and we are so thankful for that. And I want to share a little bit about camp, some changes this year, some opportunities for you all this year. So a couple things are rolling out. First of all, out in the narthex, you will see in the corner of the narthex advertisement for a youth camp. If you're wanting to get a broader picture of what youth camp is all about, there's a TV scrolling that out there, but we want your family to be a part of it. So this year, the camp schedule is a little bit differently. Traditionally, on Monday afternoon is kid drop-off, parent, drop your kids off and jet up out of there. But guess what? We want you to hang around, and in fact, we want to invite the whole church family to be with us at camp on that first Monday evening for camp service. That way you all get to be a part of it, and you get to see the campground and what all is happening down there, what your kids and what our LC3 youth are going to be into. But more importantly, we want you to experience the presence of God that we have in the past at LC3 Youth Camp. So make sure you check that out. Stop by the table. Also, what we are trying to do with the COVID and everything, the inability to do a lot of fundraising, what we would like to present to the church this morning is we're trying to raise for the youth about $2,000, and what that will do is that will reduce camp fees for campers to about $100 per camper. So there is a fence out there, and there's some envelopes hanging on it. Whatever it is that you feel that God is placing upon your heart, maybe nothing, maybe just prayers, but we'll take anything that you have to offer to be able to support LC3 Youth, and those opportunities are out there for you. Registration is underway, so make sure that you get with one of the youth leaders. Bill, back there in the back, raise your hand. That way everybody knows who you are. See him, and we'll make sure that you get plugged in to the right place. Bill, did I share everything correctly? Right on, right on. One other special announcement that I want to share with the Lighthouse Church family, and especially also you out there on live stream. You are as much a part of the here and now as anything else. So want to share special announcement. When we began to develop and work on facilities and things, we always knew that the phases of Lighthouse would be a phased construction type of building. And this past week, the General Board approved another one of those phases. And right now, plans are underway for the LC3 Kids' Playground. And so that is pretty cool. Here is pictures of some of the equipment. I know pictures probably don't really justify it, but we are so thankful for that. And honestly, if you look at the demographic change of Lighthouse Church, it has gotten younger. In fact, I was corrected in first service. Last Sunday, it was not 9, it was 10 babies and 4 toddlers that was in the nursery and toddler room last Sunday, and that is huge. That is huge. We are so thankful for the little ones that God has sent this way, and I'm so thankful to be able to present this. How do I become a part of that? Inside your worship bulletin this morning, you will see a grow envelope like this. And what this is we halted, announcing this. We halted putting this in front of you over a year ago when COVID first hit. We just felt, we knew the impact that it was going to be on families and all of that, and didn't feel that it would be right to continue the building fund. But that building fund envelope is in your worship bulletin. We have them at the connection desk. They're on the wall at the narthex. And you can also go online. You can scan that QR code. It will take you right to the online giving, and there'll be a drop down that you will be able to select building fund. You can do that for a one time. You can also schedule that to be a repeat, whatever you feel comfortable with. But we want to give you an opportunity to be a part of this awesome blessing that God has brought into our lives. So God is good, isn't He? And we are so thankful that you are here. For the sake of time, make sure you get a worship bulletin. Make sure you pay attention to the screen. There are so many opportunities and events for you and your family to be a part of, and we don't want you to miss out on any of them. If you're here for your first time, we welcome you. We're so glad that you're here. Take a moment, tear that little section called Get Connected out. Fill it out, drop it in the offering plate a little bit later. That'll just help us as a church connect with you and your family. We are so thankful that you've chose to be at home here at Lighthouse. Would you stand with us? Let's worship today.
You would call me, Oh. Desperate for you. bless your testimony you want to share this morning.
Good. I'm thankful that last weekend was so beautiful. We had our in-law and our grandson from Denver, and they were able to go to church for a long time since they've been in church, and they just really enjoyed our class and our church service and everything. And Brandon, we've been praying about the bad tumor and everything like that. His doctor came and talked to us on Monday after the procedure was done and everything, and he said, the human body is a miracle. And to me, it was a great miracle because it feels like he got the tumor under control and so good that he gave up my grandson the lead that he can start working out with his own body and his function. If you could have seen my grandson before he went in, he was just like so defeated because he was not able to take an exercise or do anything. And he could only walk a mile a day. And now I'm going to join his base, you know, that he started on his road back. So it was just tremendous.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody else want to share a blessing testimony?
Scott, baby Ellen got home. Doing good. She smiled. Alexis said she doesn't seem to be in that much pain. They're going to do a CAT scan and MRI just to check her injuries this week. Tomorrow. She's doing better.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody else this morning want to brag on the Lord?
Brad's first unit has made it safely back to the U.S.
Amazing what they can do to your eye and you can still see.
Yeah, my mom had cataract surgery this week and she came through that really well. She'll have the other eye done in a couple weeks.
So may I ask this morning when Brian got the Lord? Yes.
I just think God, my grandson's school got to have a prom this last night.
Somebody else. Share a blessing or testimony. Well, you know, I was driving to Springfield for work the other day, and you know, most of the time whenever you're driving, it's like the sun's in front of you and it sort of blinds you and you have to put your sunglasses and blinds you down. But it was real different that morning. I was driving up 70. And I reached a point where the sun was coming from behind me and it hit every one of my mirrors and almost blinded me. I had to put my sunglasses on and I thought, that's just odd. I don't know that I've really experienced it coming from the back end. And you know, the thing about it is that sun has a way of impacting you no matter what's going on, right? Somehow, some way. And you know what? We have a heavenly sun, the sun, Jesus Christ, who can impact you no matter which direction you're looking and which way you're going. He's around you and surrounds you everywhere you're at. And all you need to do is be able to heed to him. Recognize that he's in front of you, he's behind you, he's wherever he needs to be for you, if you will just allow that and recognize him to impact your life in that moment. And you know what, folks? Today is the morning to allow God to impact you. Let his son Jesus shine brighter than anything else you see. So when Pastor gets up this morning, don't even see Pastor, right? See the glow of God this morning and hear his holy word come from the scripture through Pastor this morning and allow that to impact your life in a way that's never impacted before. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, Pastor, bring it.
Shabbat, 11 a.m.
God is good. So thankful for that. So thankful for his presence. I know that he is alive and well. How do you know that? Well, him and I have been talking all morning, and he has put me through some challenging things this morning already with his word. Just so you know, you all are getting, somewhat of an edited version of this message, but this morning in first service, they were getting it from the rough notes, and here is why. I was going to preach this whole sermon today, but as I began to study it and pray through it, and I think very quickly you're going to realize and be thankful that I'm not doing the full sermon today, because I really feel like, well, we could be here for a long season, and in fact, Olivia and I had this conversation last night. I told her about my struggle for this morning. I didn't know what to do, and I said what I'd really like to do is preach for about 15 minutes, give a 5-minute invitation, and you know, we'd be done. She says, "I think you ought to go with that." I don't know where that's going to end up, babe. Just so you know, but I'm going to be obedient to the Lord. I want to show you some things that I have realized concerning a passage of Scripture that every one of you, this is an important piece of Scripture that you have used from time to time in your life. You have sung about it. You've heard sermons about it. I would say that most of you have probably even prayed about this piece of Scripture. But the question is, when you pray it, when you sing it, when you say it, when you proclaim it, do you know what it really is referring to? Do you know what it really means? And I'll be honest with you, as I began to study this and as I began to spend some time in the Word leaning into the historical piece that is behind what I'm about to preach to you this morning, the message just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So I'm just going to take a chunk of it this morning, okay? And I think it's going to be enough that you'll be able to say when I am finished that we have been to church and that God has fed us from His Word this morning. Will you be patient with your pastor and allow him to do that? I wasn't really going to approach this as a sermon series, but here we go. That's exactly where we're at, and if I was to put a title with this, it would be this: No Weapon. No Weapon. We're going to Isaiah chapter 54 this morning. And I'm using for our spiritual food today verse 17, but I want you to have more than enough spiritual food to get you through today. I want something to get you through Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then you'll come back, right? And you'll get another bowl full next Sunday of whatever the Lord has for us. So I'm going to give us a little bit of verse 17, but really I'm taking all of this, verse 14 to 17, and I want to use that for my context this morning. In fact, I'm going to give you even more than that. So here's what I'm asking. I'm asking you to write some things down. I'm asking you to take this word home with you. I'm asking you to keep it off of the bookshelf or off of your nightstand or off of the coffee table. I'm asking you to allow the Word of God to not become a dust collector this week, but I wish you would lean into His Word and allow Him to begin to speak to all of us through this, because I know He has, your pastor. No weapon. But before we can really understand what verse 17 of this passage that Isaiah gives us, that all familiar piece of Scripture that all of us have clung to at more than one occasion in our life: no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. Amen. And honestly, I could just stop right there. We could shout it out and go home. But there's so much more that needs to be said. And I want you to get the full picture. I don't want you to watch this. I don't want you to get the dessert first. Although that's pretty nice, right? Really nice, kids, when mom lets you have dessert for breakfast, right? Come on. We have a mom like that in our house. Go ahead, kids, hit the cookies. And it's all right. Hey, they've done fine, all right? They've done fine. Look at that boy, he's bigger than I am. Something worked. No weapon. But what we learn very quickly is long before God gave the prophet Isaiah these words, there was a historical context that took place That's what I want to preach to us here this morning. That's what I want us to learn about this morning, because I think it's a game changer when it comes full circle, and we will have a new appreciation. Not that we've ever thought wrong, sung wrong, preached wrong this passage of Scripture, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, but I'm saying this gives it depth. And I want your roots to be deep, that when the winds of this life blow, you will not be shaken. Before we can understand that no weapon is formed against us, or against what it says is thee, not us, shall prosper, we first must deal with the weapon within. You say, what do you mean by that? Well, in Isaiah 54:17, it's a very familiar passage. I love this passage. I've preached on this passage. You've heard us sing songs about this passage. But it's only the icing. I want you to get not only the cake, but I want you to get the crust. I want you to get the depth this morning. Let's look at the historical context. And I don't preach this to bore you this morning. I preach this to hopefully establish some help and encouragement to you. The historical context of Isaiah chapter 54 is this. We are all in a spiritual war. Watch this. Even in real time that this was written, some 600 years, or watch this, 700 years before Jesus would come, Isaiah pens this prophecy. And the truth of the matter is we learn that in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we really wrestle against powers and principalities. It's really not a wrestling match between our brother and our sister. Watch this. Spiritual darkness has an influence, and it's a constant spiritual battle that we are going through. And the same goes right here. The historical context looks like this. Isaiah the prophet receives the word of the Lord, and the prophet Isaiah delivers the word of the Lord to the king of God's people at that time, which was King Hezekiah. 700 years before Jesus came, Hezekiah, king of, watch this, Judah or Judea. In fact, it went something like this. You remember King Saul, first king of Israel, God's people, right? I'm talking about the group that Moses led out of Egyptian bondage. God still held them together, even while God took them across the River Jordan and established for them the promised land. Remember? Are you tracking with me? I want to make sure I take everybody along this journey with me. But that same people group, God's chosen people. Now, they have asked for a king. Remember, they asked for a big king, a king that looked like a king, and God gave them King Saul. Remember, because of King Saul's disobedience, because of King Saul's disobedience, remember David was chosen by God to take over his family. And David, in spite of himself, in spite of his stumbles, in spite of his sin, God still chose to use him. That's a message in and of itself, isn't it? I'm thankful for that. But you all know the story, how it goes. David done great things for the kingdom of heaven here on earth in leading God's chosen people. And then David was replaced by David's son, Solomon. Now, what we are is we've already lived through the life of Solomon when we pick up right here. And in fact, at the end of Solomon, King Solomon's reign, what happens is turmoil comes to God's people. Can you believe it? Turmoil coming to God's people. That shouldn't surprise anybody. And what happens is the kingdom of God, God's chosen people, they separate. In fact, there is what is called or known as the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom in your scripture is known as or called differently Israel. The southern kingdom is known as, called in the scriptures, Judah. Now here's what's interesting about that. Even though the northern kingdom was called Israel and the southern kingdom was called Judah, guess what the capital of the southern kingdom was? Jerusalem. All right? You say, well, why is that important? Well, during the time of Hezekiah's entrance as king of the southern kingdom, Judah, the geographical scope was somewhere between 46 and 48 major cities that made up Judea. And he entered into being the king of this people in a time of peace. Now that's important. Hang on to that. A time of peace. The capital being there in Jerusalem. Hezekiah was known as one of the most righteous kings of all of the kings of God's people. In fact, when King Hezekiah took the reign of the southern kingdom, there was some rules that had been broken. There was, can you believe this again? God's people had strayed from the relationship that they had with God. In fact, I would say it this way. The blessings that God has given his people now has become what they worship instead of the one that gave them the blessing. Now hang on with me. I know where I'm headed here. King Hezekiah instituted a new rule. In fact, when he took office, he said, in Jerusalem, no God other than the God that created all that is, the one and true God, in Jerusalem, no other God would be before the God of all creation, Yahweh. In fact, he followed that up by saying that there would be no other deity given to anything except God of all creation, Yahweh. Now, why is that important? Because we learn during the reign of Hezekiah, we learn what he was talking about, the things, the blessings that God had been and given to God's people. We learn what those things, those blessings that had become more important than the God that gave the blessing. We learn what those are. We learn that in 2 Kings chapter 8 and verse 14. And it is also mentioned in 2 Chronicles chapter 31 and verse 1. And in fact, if you want to turn there to 2 Kings chapter 8 and verse 4, what we learn is this. Speaking of Hezekiah, it says, he removed the high places and break the images and cut down the groves and break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. I want you to get that. That's so important right there. He break the brazen serpent that Moses had made into pieces. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it. You say, Pastor, what is going on? Here's what is going on. When King Hezekiah stepped in to rule God's people, he quickly realized that God's people had strayed. In fact, he quickly realized this. And it's the same problem we have today, the same problem that they had then. Don't think that we are quickly removed from it. In fact, they fell in 600 years. I feel like we have fallen much quicker. Let me give you the example. Well, here it is. Idols are taken down. See those high places? You know what those high places represent in your Old Testament? Those high places represent mountaintops where the people of God would go and build their altars for God to give honor, to give praise, to give worship unto God. But the problem was, is the location on top of the mountain, the altar that was built, became more important to the people of God than the God that gave them the blessing during the time that the altar was established. Not only did he tear down the high places, but he tore down the hedges. What do you mean by that? He tore down the protection. He tore down the things that God had already given his people. Why? Because when the people needed it, watch this, it was a blessing from God. Recall this, around Jerusalem, to protect the city of Jerusalem, there was a wall built, there were gates established. And watch this, all throughout your Old Testament, you learn the value and the blessing that those walls became. You learned the value and the blessing that those gates were. But now, all of a sudden, the walls have become more important than the God that is able to protect his people. The gates had become more important than the God that blessed them with the gates originally. You say, why is that? Why is that important? Because when King Hezekiah stepped into office, he says, take the idols down. Anything symbolic of worshiping aside from God, remove it. In fact, watch this. In that passage that I just gave you in 2 Kings 18, notice with me, the very thing that God blessed his people with had now become the very thing that they were worshiping in place of God. What is that thing? Well, it was the brazen golden serpent that Moses made. Remember, after the children of Israel are journeying through the wilderness, they came upon a place where there were serpents, and the serpents were venomous, and the snakes would bite them. And watch this, it was killing the children of Israel. And God went to Moses and said, Moses, I want you to establish my presence in the midst of the people, and I want my presence to be so recognized that when those snakes bite my people, they can look upon me and live. And Moses was instructed to form a golden serpent, place it on a rod, stand it in the middle of the people, and when someone was struck by one of these snakes, watch this, they could look upon God and live. And now all of a sudden, something that was a blessing has now become an idol. Something that is more important to them than God. And see, here's the piece, church family. Before we can understand, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, we must first take care of the weapon within. You say, what do you mean by that? Well, I don't know about you, but I am very thankful for the blessings that God has given me. He's blessed me more than what I ever deserve. He's blessed me with an awesome wife, awesome kids, an awesome church. I mean, God has been good to this old boy. But watch this. We have got to be careful that God's blessings don't become something that we worship more than God Himself. You say, oh, Pastor, that's never going to happen. Slow down. I'm not only so thankful for the way that He's blessed me, but I'm also very thankful for the way that He's blessed you. And He's blessed you in the only way that someone, that a God can. And He has been good to us. As a church family, He has been good to us. It was several years ago that we were meeting in an elementary school, setting up chairs, wheeling in and wheeling out every day. And it's like we forget that sometimes. But watch this. Don't let the blessings from God take the place of God. You say, what do you mean, Pastor? Watch this. Let's look at our families real quick and see what can happen. Blessing our families and blessing our lives and blessing our homes. What do you mean by that? Well, there was a time when you did not have a house. Remember that? Maybe you're in that season of life right now and you're praying about it and you're giving it to God and you're asking God for help and you're asking God for direction and watch this. Learn from us that have learned the hard way. Watch this. Once God gives you the blessing of the house, I'm wondering how many in here, you spend way too much time taking care of that house. All of your time, all of your energy is going into that house. All of your resources going into that house. And all of a sudden, watch this, what God blessed you with has now become more important to you than the God that gave you that house. Can it happen? It does. Is this something new? Not at all. Watch this. Not only our houses, but cars. Now, most generally, this one's not for the wives or the ladies of the church. They could probably care less as long as it smells okay. Right? Looks halfway decent and is trustworthy to get them from point A to point B because it's going to end up with McDonald's French fries all over it anyway, right? But cars. If it's not cars, it might be guns. If it's not guns, it might be bows. If it's not bows, it's the latest and greatest tree stand or the latest and greatest fishing rod, right? We had so much fun last Wednesday night, even though we got rained on. No fish, but guess what? We're going to hit it again Wednesday. You see how quickly the blessings from God can become more important than the one that gave the blessings. Let me continue. I don't want to get lost. Hobbies. I'm so thankful for hobbies. But when our hobbies become all we do, when we're living for the weekend, as they say, to go and do your hobbies, when your hobbies become more important than the God that gave you the ability to do your hobbies, there's a problem. There's a big problem. And not just hobbies, careers. See, this is a very big pitfall for some. In fact, they're constantly reaching for the next promotion. They're constantly looking for the next best job. They're constantly looking for more responsibility. They're constantly looking for more of the cutting edge. Watch this. They're constantly reaching for more money. And all of a sudden, out of the clear blue, that which you did not have and you prayed to God that you would receive has now become more important than the God that gave you the job to begin with. Lord, help us. Not just careers, but families. I want you to hear me. I want you to lean into me right here because this is concerning God blessing our lives and our homes. Watch this. How about your spouse? I believe God gave me my spouse. She is a blessing to me, and I hope I am a little bit to her. But as soon as, watch this, as soon as my spouse, which is a blessing to me, becomes more important to me than God, which gave her to me, there's a problem. How about this one, kids? We love you, kids. And watch this. Parents, you and I both know how quickly we can fall into this trap of making sure our kids have everything. Not just what they need, but even everything they want. And watch this. Have you ever made this statement? Our kids are our universe. Our life revolves around our kids. And I'm not picking fun. I am not probing the bear. I am not trying to tear off the scab. But the truth of the matter is very quickly the blessings, which you are, the blessings that God gives us very quickly can become little gods to us. Think about it. How much money, how much time, how much everything goes to the kids. And I'm not saying that that's not wrong. I'm not saying it's not important. But your kids will never be able to take the place of God in your life. It's not possible. In fact, if you put that kind of pressure on them, I believe that we're living and reaping the rewards of a generation that has felt that kind of pressure. I'm not picking on this because I love ball, whatever ball. But there are families that should be in church that somewhere behind a chain link fence screaming at the top of their, losing their voice. Come on now, I'm preaching real good to you right now, and I love you. But you and I both know it is so true. And we put everything into it. And the blessings that God has now allowed us to have become the very thing that takes the place of God in our life. And watch this. God is not honored by that. What else? Not only children, but things, land, possessions, schedules. Parents pleasing kids. Watch this. On the other side of that, kids pleasing parents. And that's a lot of pressure. Because now that we have poured everything in our life into this kid now has to live up to the expectation. What? Mom and Dad, I promise you, they will let you down. Just as Mom and Dad, we let them down too. So many places that we've got to get this right. In fact, exactly what Hezekiah says is tear down those things. Get rid of them. Mom and Dad, if this has become so important to your kids, get rid of it. In fact, if they don't have to absolutely, watch this. I'm going to help some of you. Are you ready for this? I'm serious. They don't need all that. They can't handle all that. Oh, yeah, no, you can't. I promise you, you can't. You say, well, I have to have a way to communicate. They still make flip phones. Whoop. It may not be popular, but they still make them. I think I seen one the other day. What's it called? The jitterbug or June bug or something like that. Mom and Dad, if I was you, I would not let them have it. That's not very popular, is it? The question is what about God? But watch this. It's not just blessings in our lives. It's not just blessings in our homes that become more important to us than the one that gave us the blessings. It even happens in the church. It happened to Israel. It happens even in Lighthouse. All of a sudden, very quickly, watch this. This building can become more important to us than God. Very quickly, even furniture. Your seat. If you walked in next Sunday and the seat that you have been sitting on since we walked into this building, if it was not there, ouch! See how quickly things, furniture, can become more important to us than the God that gave us that seat to sit in. Come on, I'm on it. You know I am. Watch this. And we're not just talking about furniture here. Watch this. People, we do this. Well, if so-and-so's not teaching today, I'm not going. Well, if let me call and see if our friends are going to church today, because if they're not, maybe we'll just cut out and catch it online. Huh? Tell me this does not happen. And pretty soon what happens is people become more important than God. You know what should be the primary drive for us to come to church is to worship and to come expecting God to meet us right here in this place. I don't know about you, but I couldn't make it without His presence in my life, regardless of whether you show up or not. But that's exactly what we do. Oh, so-and-so's leading that grow group. I'm going to go find me another one. See, what happens is people become more important. Well, why'd so-and-so leave? Well, maybe I should leave because so-and-so left. Come on now. People become more important. Teachers become more. Pastors become more important. Hey, you've heard me say this, and I'm not trying to wish this on me, but I could pull out of here today and get hit by a Mack truck. Would you still show up and serve God next week? You see how quickly things can happen. Watch this. What else? Pastor, I can't handle anymore. Music. We hang on to things. Programs. Bank accounts. You will not find a bigger patriot than myself, but you and I both know in the Christian Church of the United States of America that many sitting in churches this morning put their nation that is supposed to be under God as more important than God Himself. And God is not honored by it. In fact, when Hezekiah stepped in, watch this, it was peace. Why was it peace? Because they were right where Satan wanted them. They were worshiping things. They were worshiping the blessings from God more than they were worshiping the one that gave the blessing. And the devil was leaving them alone. Why mess with it? Look, it's already messed up. It's already away from God. It's already left God completely out of it. Look, the things have become more important than the God that gave the things. And why was it peace? Here's why. Because the devil had it. Had it right where he wanted it. And he said, well, I'll just give him peace. Let him just stay right there. Just stay in peace. And then Hezekiah stepped in and said, it's time to tear down the high places. It's time to tear down the hedges. It's time to get rid of, it's time to eradicate the things that we have put in front of God. It's time that we tear down the blessings of the old, because God is still alive in the present. He says it's time to hang on, or to tear down tradition. It's time to tear down those things that used to happen and used to be. Why? Because God is still alive in the present, in the now. And when He did, when He made this decree, and He removed the images, and He broke the brazen serpent that once was a blessing, but now had become their God. Watch this. The enemy, known as the Assyrian Empire, Satan thought he had lost God's people, and he went after them. And we're going to talk about that some more, and I want you to come back and hear it. But what we have to understand before we can fully grasp Isaiah 54:17, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. Before we can fully comprehend that, notice with me, we first have to deal with the weapon that's within. It's already at work. We may already be guilty of putting things, blessings, that God gave us. We would not have it if it wasn't for God. But now we have taken that blessing and we have put it, valued it, more important than God Himself. In fact, the Bible says it this way in Romans chapter 7 and verse 21, when I would do good, evil is always present. Hezekiah is now stepping in and he says it's time to get the train back on the tracks. It's time that we honor the one and true living God. And very quickly, the enemy begins to make war. You know that old saying, no good deed goes unpunished? Where do you think that comes from? Watch this. When we are about the Father's business, when we are organizing our schedules and our family around Him, you trust me, Satan will always be present. See, it's real easy to figure out what side you're on. You say, what do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, is it always perfect peace for you? Because if it is, Satan might have you right where he wants you. But if the enemy's constantly at you, righteous friend, keep living and keep doing righteous things, because that is what honors God. Every head's bowed, every eye's closed, no one's looking on here this morning. We get ready to pray here this morning. I'm not trying to put anybody on the spot. I'm not trying to embarrass anyone. But you and I both know that as Israel struggled with this, so too we, the church of today, struggles with this. And because we have allowed the blessings of God to take the place of God, God is not honored. In fact, He doesn't even feel welcome. I'm not coming to you. I'm not embarrassing you. All I want to do is pray with you. If the Lord is speaking to you this morning, I want to invite you right now. Why don't you just slip up your hand with me and say, "By that, Pastor, would you pray for me?" God bless both of you. God bless you back there. I see it. Someone else this morning, just slip it up, take it right back down. "Pastor, I'm afraid that I have put some things in my life before God." And you're right, God is not honored by it. As important as it used to be, does it honor Him right now in the present? Don't treat God as though He is dead. He is alive today. Maybe you're here this morning and maybe you've never given your heart completely to the Lord. Maybe you're out there online with us today and you have never fully committed your life to Jesus Christ. He said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes to the Father except by me." There's only one way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And if you're here this morning and the Lord is speaking to you and you have never committed your heart to Him, I want to invite you right now. Why don't you slip up your hand with me and say, "By that, Pastor, would you pray for me? Pastor, I've got questions that I'm looking for answers to. Pastor, would you just pray for me?" I see it. God bless you. Someone else this morning, pray for me. Maybe you're here this morning and maybe there was a season in your life when you knew that you were following Christ. For whatever reason, that relationship has grown cold and indifferent. Maybe your heart is not where you know it should be with God. We want to pray for you this morning. Just slip up your hand with me and say, "By that, Pastor, would you pray? Would you pray? Would you pray?" I see it. I see it. God sees it, most importantly. Someone else this morning, pray for me. Pray for me. Father in heaven, we're going to come to you right now and ask you to move me out of the way and do that which only you can do in our lives. Have your will and have your way. Be with every hand that was raised and even those that did not. Lord, speak to us. Allow us to not fall prey, to allow your blessings, as great as they are, I pray that you'll help us to not allow your blessings to become more important to us than you. We love you. We thank you for what you're about to do in Jesus' name. And amen. I'm going to invite you to stand with me this morning. There's an altar here on my right. There's an altar here on my left. And if you want God to alter you, why don't you come? God bless you, buddy. Somebody else this morning, why don't you slip out of your seat? Why don't you come right now? Why don't you come right now? Men of Lighthouse, if you would come and pray with this one that is here, someone else this morning, is the Lord speaking to you? Have we put things before God? I'm asking you right now, why don't you come? Maybe you're here this morning and maybe you have never given your heart to the Lord. Man, what a day to do that. I'm begging you, why don't you slip out of your seat and why don't you come? I would be honored. I'd be honored if this was yours. You say, "What do you mean?" Well, these Bibles have been prayed over. before you ever even got here, you were prayed over. That God of heaven would speak directly to you. I'm asking you, why don't you come this morning? Would you come? We'll pray together. We'll invite Jesus into our heart and into our lives. And know before we leave this place that we are on our way to heaven. Would you come? Would you come? Would you come? Come on. Come on. Come right now. Come on. There's still time. He's still alive. Come today. Come on. Oh, God is good. So good. Father in heaven, we give this service completely to you, thanking you, Father, that you are here. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the worship. And I pray, God, that we will not fail to give you the honor and the glory and the praise. For it's in your Son's name, Jesus, that we pray and ask these things. And amen. Why don't we give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning? Can we do that? Amen, amen, amen. Worship team's going to sing this song. Speaks directly into this passage of Scripture. Let's sing it together before we leave today.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve
Church family, give the Lord another hand clap of praise. He's good, amen. Go with God. God will go with you. God bless you as you leave today.